Thank you. next piece has particularly deep meaning for my friend Staff Sergeant Matthew Evans and myself. David N. Baker is the Distinguished Professor of Jazz Studies at Indiana University in Bloomington, Indiana. Matthew and I went to school there at the same time together. We both took a lot of classes with David. I was in his jazz big band, and he's one of my most important mentors. He was one of the preeminent jazz trombonists of the 1950s until some circumstances that were life-altering sort of changed his pathway. And he, along with Jamey, Aebersold and Jerry Coker, were the three that sort of co-founded modern jazz education in America, starting at Indiana University and sort of blossoming out from there. So all of the major universities that have jazz programs today have those guys to thank for a little bit. The amazing thing about David, after he put down the trombone, he picked up the cello and became a jazz cellist. He's a composer of big band music. He's a composer of mixed chamber music, classical and jazz, classical music influenced by jazz. This piece has a lot of melodic and harmonic devices that are very much reminiscent of Paul Hindemith's Concertstück for two alto saxophones. So this is very much a classical piece by somebody who is a jazz musician at heart. So I hope you enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Johnson's poem, Since You Went Away, was initially met with scrutiny because of the, as it was called, discriminatory dialect for which it was written in. James Weldon Johnson's response to that scrutiny was, the song is about grief, it's about sadness. The song is about a life, living in a world without the one thing that makes life worth living. And we all know that grief has no dialect. So this song is about everyone. The song is about loss. Harrison Leslie Adams knew that all too well as he set the music to this particular poem. He described it as simplicity, which is the only way that grief can match grief's complexity. Here is Leslie Adams' Since You Went Away.
Seems light to me,
second selection I will perform for you is Cecil Cohen's setting of Langston Hughes' poem, Death of an Old Seaman. Now, Cecil Cohen decided he would like to paint the picture of a dirge marching up a hill to bury an old seaman, and then later on show you how the soul of that seaman left the earth to travel to the sea that he gave his whole life for. Here is Death of an Old Seaman.
Before we get started, I'm going to read a few thoughts from Valerie Coleman, the composer of this piece. She's a flute player in Imani Wind, an all-black wind quintet. They're excellent if you're looking for something to listen to. So, the early 20th century was a new era for African-American culture. For the first time in American history, the disciplines of art, music, and literature simultaneously took a turn to celebrate African-American artists. As a result, the Harlem Renaissance was born. Langston Hughes was in the center of that cultural revolution. He was, in fact, an eyewitness to legends born. His poems are descriptive of this era, with references to particular settings and individuals that influenced him, Josephine Baker, Helen Keller, the nightlife and music of Harlem jazz clubs, and Parisian cabarets. Portraits of Langston is a suite in 6 short movements and is a take on Hughes' poetic memories of Harlem and Europe.
Helen Keller. She in the dark found light, brighter than any ever see. She within herself found loveliness, though through the soul's own mastery. And now the world receives from her dower the message of the strength of inner power. Dance, African, the low beating of the tom-toms, the slow beating of the tom-toms, low, slow, slow, low, stirs your blood. Dance, a night-veiled girl whirls softly into a circle of light, whirls softly, slowly, like a wisp of smoke around the fire, and the tom-toms beat, and the tom-toms beat, and the low beating of the tom-toms stirs your blood.
Thank you.
One night, there was a terrific fight at the Grand Duke. It began like this. A little French danseuse named Annette was going to have a child. Feeling badly, no doubt, Annette began to be very spiteful to those clients who didn't think that they could afford another bottle of champagne. So one night, the owner of the place asked her not to come back anymore. He called an attendant to eject her. Annette would not go. The attendant laid hands on her and pushed her, struggling in her satin evening gown, toward the door. As she passed the last table, Annette seized a patron's champagne bucket ice, bottle and all, and flung it straight at the proprietor at his cash desk behind the bar, whereupon the attendant slapped Annette to the floor with one blow of his hand. Then it was that Florence, the famous entertainer, the same Florence who snubbed millionaires nightly, arose from her table near the orchestra to defend the poor little danseuse in her trouble. Florence wore an evening gown of gold and a spray of orchids in her hair. She swept across the floor like a handsome tigress, blocking the path of the waiters who, at the bidding of the management, rushed to eject the little danseuse. Florence said, "Don't touch that woman. She's a woman and I'm a woman. And can't nobody hit a woman in any place where I work anyway. Don't put your hands on that woman." By that time, the little danseuse had risen from the floor and seized yet another ice bucket, which she sent whirling into space. Customers dodged behind tables. The orchestra struck up, "Tuck Me to Sleep in My Old Kentucky Home," to drown out the noise. The waiter did lay hands on the danseuse, but Florence laid hands on the waiter. Then the Negro manager laid hands on Florence, and the battle royale began between the women and those who sided with the women, and the management and those who sided with the men. Thank you. time of silver rain, the earth puts forth new life again. Green grasses grow and flowers lift their heads. And over all the plain, the wonder spreads of life, of life, of life. In the time of silver rain, the butterflies lift silken wings to catch a rainbow cry. And trees put forth new leaves to sing in joy beneath the sky. As down the roadway, passing boys and girls go singing too, in the time of silver rain when spring and life are new.
Thank you.
Parisian cabaret. Play that thing, jazz band. Play it for the lords and the ladies, for the dukes and the counts, for the whores and the gigolos, for the American millionaires and the school teachers out for a spree. Play it, jazz band. You know that tune that laughs and cries at the same time. You know it. May I? May we? Mein Gott? Paris un rumba? Play it, jazz band. You've got 7 languages to speak in and then some, even if you do come from Georgia. Can I go home with you, sweetie? Sure. Harlem summer night. The sounds of the Harlem night drop one by one into stillness. The last player piano is closed. The last Victrola ceases with the jazz boy blues. The last crying baby sleeps, and the night becomes still as a whispering heartbeat. I toss without rest in the darkness. Weary as the tired night, my soul, empty as the silence, empty with a vague, aching emptiness, desiring, needing someone, something. I toss without rest in the darkness until the new dawn, wan and pale, descends like a white mist into the courtyard.
Thank you. lot of great music tonight. Thank you also for those of us joining us online. I wanted to just say a few words about the piece we're about to perform. It's by Samuel Coleridge Taylor, composed in 1895. And Coleridge Taylor's mother was from England, and his father was a descendant of African-American slaves that were freed by the British after the American Revolutionary War. So he has a really interesting background. He was born in 1875, raised in England, studied at the Royal College of Music alongside Vaughan Williams and Holst. And Elgar described Coleridge Taylor as, quote, far and away the cleverest fellow going amongst the young men. He was very well received in the U.S. in the early 1900s. In 1904, President Theodore Roosevelt invited him to the White House, and he was even described as the African Mahler or the African Dvorak by U.S. orchestral musicians. To show his importance in the U.S., even today, there's actually an elementary school in Baltimore named the Samuel Coleridge Taylor Elementary School, so his legacy lives on not too far from where we are. So this clarinet quintet we're going to perform, he composed it at age 20, which is amazing given the complexity and genius that you'll hear in this work. And I was wondering, has anyone here heard this piece performed before? That's so cool. Okay, I'm glad you all are going to get to hear it for the first time. And that also is such a good example of how underperformed this piece has been, unfortunately. And I discovered this only through this concert, and I'm so glad to have gotten to know this piece, and I plan to perform it again. And I believe that it really needs to be heard. It's a fantastic piece. We have all compared it to Dvorak and Borodin. I think it's similar to the Brahms quintet, clarinet quintet. I think it should be viewed as a partner to that piece. So again, thank you all for coming. Thank you for listening to this wonderful music, and I hope you enjoy our performance.
Thank you.